Hachette Audio presents The Standardization of Demoralization Procedures, written by Jennifer Hofmann, read by Michael Fenner.
Chapter 1. Subchapter 1.1. Something must have happened. Bernd Zeiger had snored himself awake and did not know where he was. A wedge of light on the ceiling caught his eye. He followed its journey as it stretched and narrowed until the car from which it came disappeared down the road. Darkness returned to the bedroom like a calamity. It was November, strong westerly winds and a drizzle. He strained his eyes into the shadows. A wooden dresser loomed next to his bed, dark and wide like the hull of a ship. A nightstand held up a clock and a tall glass of water. He looked at his things as if they were not his things, as if someone had entered and exchanged all his things for replicas of the things he should know. Lara, he remembered, was gone. The wheezing nozzle of a cleaning vehicle approached along the cobblestone street. It hummed and rattled as it suctioned debris from the road. Loose newspaper pages, wet leaves, abandoned tin toys, umbrella skeletons, the bloated bodies of rats, small-scale pandemonium. Zeiger pictured the driver as necklace and moustached, a sadist. Street cleaning arrived at 4:30, the loneliest hour. Beyond the receding noise of the vehicle, the murmur of morning traffic echoed along Torstrasse, people driving to work, others returning from night shifts. Zeiger's legs were caught in a complicated knot of sheets, his pyjamas twisted almost entirely the wrong way around. A hand was clasping the edge of a pillow, his own. These were his things: dresser, nightstand, pyjama, pillow. The ancient, indisputable objects of his life. The alarm clock pierced a hole in the darkness. He slapped at it like he would at a gnat. It was more than 2 hours earlier than his usual time, but anticipation had outraced his alarm. A thump in the apartment next door announced Schreibmüller, his neighbour, a blind man who refused government aid like walking sticks or guide dogs, and navigated spaces by bumping through them instead. There was the choppy rhythm of another language, Ukrainian perhaps. Despite his disability, Schreibmüller appeared to be surrounded by a harem of women and preferred, as far as Zeiger had learned from stairwell encounters over the last decades, Eastern types with sharp cheekbones and porcine eyes. He had considered asking Schreibmüller how, logistically speaking, a blind man could determine a type, but the occasion for it had never materialized. The world threw mysteries at him in passing. At 60, moving into an upright position in the morning felt like an unconquerable task. There was an indentation in his mattress from many years of sleeping, and it enveloped the loose meat of his body like the arms of a wife.
"If you wake at this age without pain, you're dead," an elderly woman had told someone in line at the Konsum.
He had found that insightful. A lull in her voice suggested she longed for the latter state. Management had assured him he would be finished at Hohenschönhausen jail by 8 o'clock, the time he would, on normal days, go for cheese toast and milk coffee at the corner café to see Lara, the waitress. He would keep his regular routine despite an irregular start to the day. That was a comfort, even if Lara had vanished several weeks ago. A roar like that of an ailing beast echoed from the street. He stretched out an arm and yanked the cord of his nightstand lamp. Light replaced darkness. After street cleaning came trash collection. There was an order to things. Above the sound of the truck, garbage men hollered to one another, shouting combatively. Zeiger rolled toward the nightstand, gaped into the dusty light. He dropped his legs off the side of the bed. His feet found his slippers. Gravity popped his bones into position. He rested his forearms on his knees, letting the folds of his body expand. Then he plucked his bathrobe from the hook by the nightstand and draped it over his shoulders. It took a moment to absorb the heat of his body. The coal oven was a moody piece of work and needed constant attention. There would be no use in firing it up this morning. It would take a good half hour, and periodic poking of the embers even to warm the tiles, an hour before the bedroom was fully heated. He'd be in Hohenschönhausen by then. After Hohenschönhausen, the café, then an ordinary day at his desk, followed by another press conference in the evening he'd been ordered to observe. Thursday meant Kettwurst Day at the ministry cafeteria, something to look forward to. The woman on the phone the night before, a low-level secretary, no doubt, had all but screamed at him, sounding shrill and panic-stricken, like a woman in the habit of losing her child in strange places. Hysteria was trickling down the ranks. He was to report to Hohenschönhausen jail for the interrogation of someone or other, she said. Bitte schön, danke schön, gute Nacht, Kamerad Zeiger. It had been more than 20 years since he was last at the jail. There was another thump next door, followed by a gargling of pipes, giggles and splashing sounds, all of which suggested that Schreibmüller and his guest had moved their operation to the tub. Zeiger had the urge to pound the wall, but he resisted and rose from the bed. By the time he reached the window, dots were dancing before his eyes, things that were not there. Then Lara's face appeared, a prim and taunting smile which caused the air to escape from his lungs with an awful hacking sound. He found the windowsill and steadied himself, peering into blackness. Outside, the hollow rhythm of heels on cobblestones, the unoiled wheel of a bicycle, traffic. Inside, the sound of his own heart furiously pumping blood to his brain by way of his ears. Only a few windows in the building opposite glowed with light. He saw no movements in them. Through a gap in the buildings, the TV tower antenna blinked with the soothing rhythm of a digital clock. The night sky was shrouded in clouds. Not long ago, street lamps had been outfitted with high-watt bulbs in emergency orange, a colour so glaring it obliterated any trace of a star. Street lamps in West Berlin had retained their soft yellow glow, but, as Zeiger had noticed during occasional visits, the night sky there was still as tremendous and black as their own. He did not register that he was smoking until he had opened the window and rested his elbows on the iced ledge outside. The bakery below was closed. It was not yet 5 o'clock, but a line had already formed. 7 early risers stood in thick coats and raised collars, their faces and shoulders turned against the wind. The street lamp threw a distressing light on the scene, adding to it an air of quiet catastrophe. By Zeiger's usual time, the line would have swollen and dispersed, and the bakery would have closed again, leaving a few latecomers to pace the corner like stray dogs. A woman in a towering ushanka arrived and placed herself at the end of the line, raising its count to 8. A man acknowledged her presence with a nod, then turned again to face the front of the line. Limited food, and people trusting strangers with the naked planes of their backs. The pinnacle of human evolution. Zeiger smoked his cigarette down to the filter and tossed the butt out of the window. After a brief flight, it landed, spraying the ground with sparks, and died. No one looked up to seek out its origin. The kitchen greeted him with a new shade of darkness and the bitter smell of cooked cabbage. He turned on the overhead light, then dropped an egg into a pot of water, stood over it as it boiled. He filled the coffee cooker, added a spoonful of coffee, put it on the stove, waited. This was not coffee. It was coffee, pea flour, and disgrace. This was café mix, and tasted like a nosebleed. One bad harvest in Brazil, a coffee shortage, and the largest revolts the Republic had seen since 1953. An entire nation with the jitters. Even well-stocked inter shops for foreigners and party and ministry officials had not sold real coffee in years. More than real coffee, Zeiger missed sweetbread loaves, which people now bought in bulk as exchange presents for relatives who sent real coffee from the West. There'd been talks of sweetbread gifting prohibitions, which he had supported, but the party had voted against it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.